What does democracy look like? Resistance, says Biggers, and it's the story he tells in his latest book, Resistance, Reclaiming an American Tradition. Welcome back, Jeff. Great to have you.
Thanks so much for having me, Laura.
Really so, I mean, you say this was kind of an act of love for your family and your son. Take us back to that moment, because you've been writing about how hugely powerful some forces in this country are, and then you come out with, well, maybe we can beat them.
You know, my son looked at me, and this was right after President Trump pulled out of the Paris Climate Accords, and of course, the only country in the world to do so. And my son had often heard me speak about climate change and whatnot, and I think he was expecting some sort of lecture, and he came to me and he said, "Dad, is there any hope for us now?" Meaning his generation. And you know, when a 12-year-old looks at you and says that, you just can't be glib. You can't just say, "Oh yeah, you know, just be nice to your friends and recycle your pop bottle."
Right.
You know, I had to really think, how am I gonna respond to this? And I couldn't just simply say, yes, we can go do climate action and maybe there is hope. Because I think we are facing irreversible destruction to our environment right now. And we are in one of the darkest times of our history. And so I had to go back to our roots, to our beginnings. And you know, Laura, as you say, this is my eighth book. I see myself almost as a cultural historian of the resistance. I've gone region by region looking how people have reclaimed their incredible stories and histories of resistance. And I felt I needed to do it on a national basis, going back not only to the American Revolution, but even before that.
So is there hope?
Oh, there's so much hope. You know, I looked at my son and I said, I need to tell you a story about being in Washington in 1985. I was 21 years old, and we began to realize, you know, President Reagan at that period refused to put sanctions against our apartheid. In fact, he called Nelson Mandela a communist agent, and we allowed apartheid to go on, and there was just absolutely no interference here in the United States. And we felt that was wrong. We had to do something about it. Here, Mandela had been in prison more than I actually had been on this planet. And so we came down to Washington. I was here in New York City at Riverside Church, and we began to blockade the doors of the South African embassy day after, day in, day after. People from around the country, over 400 days we had this sit-in. It was really one of the most amazing movements in our country for the Free South Africa movement. Once again, not to change what was happening there, but to change our own government's complicity to apartheid. And when I was in jail there in Washington, I was sitting with William Sloan Coffin, the great minister and civil rights activist and anti-war activist and someone who had actually fought through World War II. And he could see I was fidgety and I was saying, "Bill, this is ridiculous. We're not gonna change anything. It's hopeless." And Bill sat me down on this concrete bench in Washington in the jail and he said, "Jeff, I'm gonna tell you something I learned in 1961. He was one of the first white preachers to go down on the freedom rides. And he said, "There in Alabama, we were arrested, taken off, brutalized, put in jail." And he said, "There, young African-American saw that he was being fidgety. And they sat him down and said, you know, hopelessness adapts, but hope resists." And I think that is the kind of spirit we have to approach today with the White House and President Trump.
Are the people in this book who were new to you? Did you discover new people? I certainly did as I was looking at it.
You know, I felt like I needed to tell stories of people beyond sort of the founding fathers, people who often we talk about these watershed moments, you know, the Boston Tea Party. And we forget, for example, the Boston Tea Party was very unpopular. That, in fact, Benjamin Franklin wrote a letter saying, you know, you really ought to pay for that tea that you threw into the water. And that, in fact, it's, you know, resistance is in the eyes of the beholder and mainly in the eyes of the powerful. And so I had to go back to people we've often forgotten about, people who are fundamental to our country. For example, someone who's quite known to us, but not to most Americans. And that is the very writer who gave us the name, the United States of America. And that was the great British author. He was an undocumented immigrant named Thomas Paine, someone who was a complete failure, twice went into debt, twice had his marriage break up, someone who couldn't even become a tax collector in England. He was such a failure. He gets on the boat, he barely survives, he gets off on a stretcher, and somehow in Philadelphia, he manages to start a magazine. And there in 1775, once again, this immigrant who came for the fiery reasons of independence that he had so much heard about, realized there was this colonial elite that was willing to be complicit and reconcile, almost like a democratic establishment in Congress.
Mm.
You know, and Paine pushed them. You know, he said, "Hey, are we all gonna be working with this young movement in Philadelphia?" There was this incredible young movement of immigrants and merchants. And once again, he pointed out, "Hey, less than a third of the people in Philadelphia are native English speakers. Why are we talking about this English constitution?" And he went on, of course, to change the course of our nation with his common sense and, more importantly, his American crisis that forced us, in fact, to not only fight the revolution, but to seed this fundamental credo. Laura, and this is really the theme of my book, is that it's our patriotic duty to resist duplicitous authority when it attacks our democracy.
There's so many great stories in the book, and I could have you here talk about all of them. I love stories like this, but it also occurs to me that we do tell a story of resistance about this country that is sometimes overstated. And even just looking at that moment from 1776, the Declaration of Independence, we the people, to 86, when the actual Constitution gets written, and it's kind of different in its respect, in its treatment of freedom, becomes a lot more about freedom of yourself to have your property and not have it messed with. Do we sometimes overstate how much resistance spirit actually made it into our founding documents? And what happened in that decade to change things?
Right, you know, that's a great question. And immediately after the revolution, we immediately had rebellions in the back country because the Continental Congress met and began a taxation process that people in the rural areas thought was very unfair, that it was favoring the colonial elite, people who were in power. George Mason was one of our forgotten founders, who did the Virginia Declaration of 1775, and in fact, he gave us the happiness and the life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Right. Our original original document was life, liberty, and the pursuit of property. And of course, Mason changed that. Mason was one of three men who walked out of the Constitutional Convention and refused to sign because of many reasons. One, he said, hey, if we're not going to end slavery, we're not living up to the aspirations of what we've talked about. And two, he said, we're giving too much power to an aristocracy that is rising. And he felt even the giving the president the right to pardon, which we're seeing now with President Trump, was something that was going to be misused. He said, we're very close to an aristocracy or a monarchy. And so I think what you saw from the very beginning was the credo of resistance, once again, that Paine and many other people, Phyllis Wheatley, as you said, the wonderful African-American poet, and many other people, were saying that this credo of resistance is not just going to go away because we gained our independence, but in fact, we have seeded our resistance into the American, quintessential American experience.
You eventually, much later on, quote Valerie Kaur from the Revolutionary Love Project, who talks about resistance alone will not deliver us. We must give birth, or we must birth a new nation. Naomi Klein, too, says resistance is not enough. What else do we need in addition to resistance, and where do you see that?
Right. I think that's very powerful, but I also feel like resistance is not a singular thing. Resistance is not just protest. It's not just registering people to vote. It's not just getting into the streets. It's not just going into the courts and challenging, you know, wrong decisions on immigration policy. Resistance is also an agency of renewal, as Thomas Paine said. It's you know, Paine said, we have it in our power to reinvent the world. And I think that's what I'm talking about when I talk about resistance is in the bigger context, that we have to reframe resistance as an agency of renewal. My last chapter speaks about cities of resistance. And what I mean by that is we have to move in the directions of regenerative cities like we're seeing across the world of people who realize, hey, we can't just have carbon emissions. We can't just import 90% of our food. We can't just have these lights, you know, burning from coal and natural gas. So we have to begin to create a circular economy. We have to challenge elements of capitalism and move in the direction of a regenerative society, a circular society that actually is going to be sustainable.
Finally, well, you've brought us back to the environment, and I'm glad you did. While we have been resisting, lots of individuals, and Scott Pruitt from the EPA was one of the ones who got an awful lot of attention in the first part of this Trump administration, eventually resigned. Are we missing perhaps what's actually being done by some of these people? And have you been keeping an eye on what's actually going on at EPA? Do we focus too much on individuals?
You know, I think once again, it's a great point. We were kind of obsessed because Pruitt was almost a larger than life character with his personal scandals and his involvement with the natural gas companies and of course his Oklahoma background. Meanwhile, 67 major environmental regulations have been reversed. And I see that personally, of course, as a reporter in the coal fields. You know, the Clean Water Act, which was passed and forced under President Nixon, was one way we were able to at least stabilize and set certain restrictions on how close coal mining companies could dump their waste and heavy metals into our water. And still it wasn't enforced. You know, and we had been working and reporting on that for years. And now they've even removed that restriction that coal companies can dump directly into waterways. And we're talking, Laura, things like heavy metals like lead and selenium and arsenic, which are really poisoning and killing and American citizens. And so, yes, we are really seeing some major damages, which I call almost irreversible damages. And the new EPA chief who's coming on, if he keeps the position, we're hearing that, in fact, he may want to transition out, is a former coal lobbyist who worked for probably the worst coal company in the country. You know, Bob Murray, Murray Energy, who was behind the Crandall Canyon disaster in Utah, who ran one of the worst coal mines in Southern Illinois, where my family's from, who's led this industry in a state of continual lawlessness and violations. And that is the man who we've asked now to protect our environment. So I think we have to get beyond the personnel and really look at the policies themselves and in many sense resist these directly.
Long scope of history. Resistance, reclaiming an American tradition. Jeff, thank you so much. The book's out now. You can get more information at our website. Jeff Biggers, everybody.